Hello everyone, welcome to my channel. I am M.K. Jabintash. Today in this video I am giving you the knowledge about the fourth module of the subject application development using Python for 5th sem CSE CBCS VTU students. I am dedicating this video to all the students all over the world. Now let us see module 4th of the subject application development using Python. Classes and objects. Programmer defined types. We have used many of Python's built-in types. Now we are going to define a new type. As an example, we will create a type called point that represents a point in a two-dimensional space. In mathematical notation, points are often written in parentheses with a comma separating the coordinates. For example, 0, 0 represents the origin and x, y represents the point x units to the right and y units up from the origin. There are several ways we might represent points in Python. We could store the coordinates separately in two variables x and y. We could store the coordinates as elements in a list or tuple. We could create a new type to represent points as objects. Creating a new type is more complicated than the other options, but it has advantages that will be apparent soon. A programmer defined type is also called a class. A class definition looks like this. See the box here. The header indicates that the new class is called point. The body is a doc string that explains what the class is for. You can define variables and methods inside a class definition, but we will get back to that later. Defining a class named point creates a class object. See the box here. Because point is defined at the top level, its full name is main point. The class object is like a factory for creating objects. To create a point, you call a point as if it were a function. See the box here. The return value is reference to a point object which we assign to blank. Creating a new object is called instantiation, and the object is an instance of the class. When you print an instance, Python tells you what class it belongs to and where it is stored in memory. The prefix ox means that the following number is in hexadecimal. Second one is attributes. You can assign values to an instance using dot notation. See the box here. This syntax is similar to the syntax for selecting a variable from a module such as math.py or string.whitespace. In this case, though, we are assigning values to named elements of an object. These elements are called attributes. A state diagram that shows an object and its attributes is called an object diagram. See the figure 15.1. The variable blank refers to a point object which contains two attributes. Each attribute refers to a floating point number. You can read the value of an attribute using the same syntax. See here. The expression blank.x means go to the object blank refers to and get the value of x. In the example, we assign that value to a variable named x. There is no conflict between the variable x and the attribute x. You can use dot notation as part of any expression. For example, see here. You can pass an instance as an argument in the usual way. For example, see here. Print point takes a point as an argument and displays it in mathematical notation. To invoke it, you can pass blank as an argument. See here. Inside the function, p is an alias for blank. So if the function modifies p, blank changes. Third one is rectangles. Sometimes it is obvious what the attributes of an object should be, but other times you have to make decisions. For example, imagine you are designing a class to represent rectangles. What attributes would you use to specify the location and size of a rectangle? You can ignore angle to keep things simple. Assume that the rectangle is either vertical or horizontal. There are at least two possibilities. You could specify one corner of the rectangle or the center, the width and the height. You could specify two opposing corners. At this point, it is hard to say whether either is better than the other. So we will implement the first one just as an example. Here is the class definition. See here, the doc string lists the attributes width and the height are numbers. Corner is a point object that specifies the lower left corner. To represent a rectangle, you have to instantiate a rectangle object and assign values to the attributes. See the here. The expression box.corner.x means go to the object box refers to and select the attribute named corner, then go to that object and select the attribute named x. See the figure 15.2 shows the state of this object. An object that is an attribute of another object is embedded. Fourth one is instances as return values. Functions can return instances. For example, find center takes a rectangle as an argument and returns a point that contains the coordinates of the center of the rectangle. See here. Here is an example that passes box as an argument and assigns the resulting point to the center. Fifth one is objects are mutable. You can change the state of an object by making an assignment to one of its attributes. For example, to change the size of the rectangle without changing its position, you can modify the values of width and height. See here. You can also write functions that modify objects. For example, grow rectangle takes a rectangle object and two numbers, d width and d height, and adds the numbers to the width and height of the rectangle. Here is an example that demonstrates the effect. See here. Inside the function, rect is an alias for box. So when the function modifies rect, box changes. Sixth one is copying. Aliasing can make a program difficult to read because changes in one place might have unexpected effects in another place. It is hard to keep track of all the variables and might refer to a given object. Copying an object is often an alternative to aliasing. The copy module contains a function called copy that can duplicate any object. P1 and P2 contains the same data, but they are not the same point. See here. See the example box here. This is operator in this. The is operator indicates that P1 and P2 are not the same object, which is what we expected. But you might have expected double is equal to yield true because these points contain the same data. In that case, you will be disappointed to learn that, for instance, the default behavior of the double is equal to operator is the same as the is operator. It checks object identify, not object equivalence. That's because for programmer defined types, Python doesn't know what should be considered equivalent, at least not yet. See the figure here. If you use copy.copy to duplicate a rectangle, you will find that it copies the rectangle object but not the embedded point. See here. See the figure 15.3 shows what the object diagram looks like. This operation is called shallow copy because it copies the object and any reference it contains but not the embedded objects. For most applications, this is not what you want. In this example, invoking grow rectangle on one of the rectangles would not affect the other, but invoking move rectangle on either would affect both. This behavior is confusing and error prone. Fortunately, the copy module provides a method named deep copy that copies not only the object but also the objects it refers to and the objects they refer to and so on. You will not be surprised to learn that this operation is called a deep copy. See here. Box 3 and box are completely separate objects. Now let us see classes and functions. First time, as another example of programmer data type, we will define a class called time that records the time of the day. The class definition looks like this. See here, box. We can create a new time object and assign attributes for hours, minutes and seconds. See here example. This state diagram for the time object looks like the figure below here. Second one is pure functions. In the next few sections, we will write two functions that add time values. They demonstrate two kinds of functions, pure functions and modifiers. They also demonstrate a development plan. I will call prototype and patch, which is a way of tackling a complex problem by starting with a simple prototype and incrementally dealing with the complications. Here is a simple prototype of add time. See here. The function creates a new time object, initializes its attributes and returns a reference to the new object. This is called a pure function because it does not modify any of the object passed to it as arguments, and it has no effect like displaying a value or getting user input other than returning a value. To test this function, let us create two time objects. Start contains the start time of a movie like Monty Python and a Holy Grail, and duration contains the run time of the movie, which is 1 hour 35 minutes. Add time figures out when the movie will be done. See here box. The result 10:80:00 might not be what you were hoping for. The problem is that this function does not deal with cases where the number of seconds or minutes adds up to more than 60. When that happens, we have to carry the extra seconds into the minute column or the extra minutes into the hour column. Here is an improved version. See here. Third one is modifiers. Sometimes it is useful for a function to modify the object it gets as a parameter. In that case, the changes are visible to the caller. Functions that work this way are called modifiers. Increment, which adds a given number of seconds to a time object, can be written naturally as a modifier. Here is a rough draft. See here. The first line performs the basic operation. The remainder deals with the special cases we saw before. Is this function correct? What happens if seconds is much greater than 60? In that case, it is not enough to carry once. We have to keep doing it until time dot second is less than 60. One solution is to replace the if statement with while statement. That would make the function correct but not very efficient. Anything that can be done with modifiers can also be done with pure functions. Now let us see prototyping versus planning. The development plan that is demonstrating is called prototype and patch. For each function, we wrote a prototype that performed the basic calculation and then tested it, patching errors along the way. This approach can be effective, especially if you don't yet have a deep understanding of the problem, but incremental corrections can generate code that is unnecessarily complicated, since it deals with many special cases and unreliable, since it is hard to know if you have found all the errors. Here is a function that converts times to integers. See here. And here is a function that converts an integer to time. Recall that dev mode divides the first argument by the second and returns the quotient and remainder as a tuple. See here. Once we are convinced they are correct, they can use them to rewrite. This version is shorter than the original and easier to verify. Now let us see classes and methods. Object-oriented features. Python is an object-oriented programming language, which means that it provides features that support object-oriented programming, which has these defining characteristics. Programs include class and method definitions. Most of the computation is expressed in terms of the operations on objects. Objects often represent things in the real world, and methods often correspond to the ways things in the real world interact. A method is a function that is associated with a particular class. Methods are semantically the same as functions, but there are two syntactic differences. Methods are defined inside a class definition in order to make the relationship between the class and the method explicit. The syntax of invoking a method is different from the syntax for calling a function. Second one is printing objects. So we already defined a class named and also wrote a function named printTime. See here. To call this function, we have to pass a time object as an argument. See here. To make printTime a method, all we have to do is move the function definition inside the class definition. Notice the change in indentation. See here. Now there are two ways to call printTime. The first and the less common way is to use a function syntax. See here. In this use of a dot notation, time is the name of the class and printTime is the name of the method. Start is passed as a parameter. The second and the more conscious way is to use a method syntax. In this use of dot notation, printTime is the name of the method again and start is the object. The method is invoked on what is called the subject, just as the subject of a sentence is what the sentence is about. The subject of the method invocation is what the method is about. Inside the method, the subject is assigned to the first parameter. So in this case, start is assigned to time. By convention, the first parameter of the method is called self. So it would be more common to write printTime like this. See here. The reason for this convention is an implicit metaphor. The syntax for a function called printTime start suggests that the function is the active agent. It says something like, "Hey printTime, here is an object for you to print." In object-oriented programming, the objects are the active agents. A method invocation like start print time says, "Hey start, please print yourself." Third one is another example. Here is a version of increment rewritten as a method. See here. This version assumes that time to int is written as a method. Also note that it is a pure function and not a modifier. Here is how you would invoke increment. See here. The object start gets assigned to the first parameter self. The argument 1337 gets assigned to the second parameter seconds. This mechanism can be confusing, especially if you make an error. For example, if you invoke increment with two arguments, you get, see here, the error message is initially confusing because there are only two arguments in parentheses, but the subject is also considered as an argument. So altogether, that's 3. By the way, a positional argument is an argument that doesn't have a parameter name. That is, it is not a keyword argument in this function call. See here. Parrot and cage are positional and dead is a keyword argument. Fourth one is a more complicated example. Rewriting is after is slightly more complicated because it takes two time objects as parameters. In this case, it is conventional to the name first parameter self and the second parameter other. See here box. To use this method, you have to invoke it on one object and pass the other as an argument. Fifth one is the init method. The init method, shorter for initialization, is a special method that gets invoked when an object is instantiated. Its full name is init, 2 underscore characters followed by init and then 2 more underscores. An init method for the time class might look like this. See the box here. It is common for the parameters of init to have the same names as the attributes. This statement self dot hover is equal to hover stores the value of the parameter hover as an attribute of self. The parameters are optional, so if you call time with no arguments, you get the default values. See here. If we provide one argument, it overrides hours. If we provide two arguments, they override hours and minutes. And if we provide three arguments, they override all three default values. The str method. Str is a special method like init that is supposed to return a string representation of an object. For example, here is a string method for time object. See here. When you print an object, Python invokes the str method. Now let us say operator overloading. By defining other special methods, you can specify the behavior of operators on programmer defined types. For example, if we define a method named add for the time class, you can use the plus operator on time objects. Here is what the definition might look like, and here is how we could use it. See here continuation. When you apply the plus operator to time objects, Python invokes add. When you print the result, Python invokes str. So there is a lot of happening behind the scenes. Changing the behavior of an operator so that it works with programmer defined types is called operator overloading. For every operator in Python, there is a corresponding special method like add. Type based dispatch. The following is the version of add that checks the type of the other and invokes either add time or increment. See here. The built-in function in is instance takes a value and a class object and returns true if the value is an instance of the class. If other is a time object, add invokes add time. Otherwise, it assumes that the parameter is a number and invokes increment. This operation is called type-based dispatch because it dispatches the computation to different methods based on the type of the arguments. Here are examples that use the plus operator with different types. See here. Unfortunately, this implementation of addition is not commutative. If the integer is the first operand, you get, see here. The problem is instead of asking the time object to add an integer, Python is asking an integer to add a time object and does not know how. But there is a clever solution for this problem, the special method rad, which stand for right side add. This method is invoked when a time object appears on the right side of the plus operator. Here is the definition. See here. Now let us see polymorphism. Type based dispatch is useful when it is necessary, but fortunately it is not always necessary. Often you can avoid it by writing functions that work correctly for arguments with different types. Many of the functions we wrote for strings also work for other sequence types. For example, we used histogram to count the number of times each letter appears in a word. See here. This function also works for the list, tuples and even dictionaries as long as the elements of S are hashable, so they can be used as keys in D. See here code. Functions that work with several types are called polymorphic. Polymorphism can facilitate code reuse. For example, the built-in function sum, which adds the elements of a sequence, works as long as the elements of the sequence support addition. See here, in general, if all of the operations inside a function works with a given type, the function works with that type. The best kind of polymorphism is the unintentional where you discover that a function you already wrote can be applied to a type you never planned for. Now let us see inheritance, card objects, class attributes, comparing cards, decks, printing the deck, add, remove, shuffle and sort, inheritance, class diagrams, data encapsulation. First is card objects. There are 52 cards in a deck, each of which belongs to one of 4 suite and one of 13 ranks. The suits are spades, hearts, diamonds and clubs. The ranks are as 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, jack, queen and king. If we want to define a new object to represent a playing card, it is obvious what the attributes should be, rank and suit. One possibility is to use strings containing words like spade for suits and queen for ranks. An alternative is to use integers to encode the ranks and suits. In this context, encode means that we are going to define a mapping between numbers and suits or between numbers and ranks. See the example here. This code makes it easy to compare cards because higher suit map to higher numbers. We can compare suits by comparing their codes. The mapping for ranks is fairly obvious. Each of the numerical ranks maps to the corresponding integer and for face cards. See here, the symbol arrow mark symbol to make it clear that these mappings are not part of the Python program. They are part of the program design, but they don't appear explicitly in the code. The class definition for card looks like this. See here. As usual, the init method takes an optional parameter for each attribute. The default card is the 2 of clubs. To create a card, we call card with the suit and rank of the card you want. Now let us see class attributes. In order to print a card, we need a mapping from the integer codes to the corresponding ranks and suits. A natural way to do that is with lists of strings. We assign these lists to a class attributes. See here. Variables like suit names and rank names, which are defined inside a class but outside of any method, are called class attributes because they are associated with the class object card. The variables like suit and rank, which are called instance attributes because they are associated with a particular instance. Both kinds of attribute are assessed using dot notation. Example, in str self is a card object and self dot rank is its rank. Similarly, card is an object, card is a class object and card dot rank names is a list of strings associated with the class. The first element of rank names is none because there is no card with rank 0. By including none as a place keeper, we get a mapping with the nice property that the index 2 maps to the string 2 and so on. To avoid this tweak, we could have used a dictionary instead of a list. With the methods we have so far, we can create and print cards. See here, figure object diagram. Now let us see comparing cards. For built-in types, there are relational operators that compare values and determine when one is greater than, less than or equal to another. For user-defined types, we can override the behavior of the built-in operators by providing a method named comp. Comp takes two parameters, self and other, and returns a positive number if the first object is greater, a negative number if the second object is greater, and zero if they are equal to each other. See here code. The built-in function comp has the same interface as the method comp. It takes two values and returns a positive if the first is larger, a negative number if the second is larger, and zero if they are equal. In Python 3, comp no longer exists and the comp method is not supported. Instead, you should provide it which returns true if the self is less than other. So you can implement it using tuples and the lesser than operator. LT means lesser than operator. Now let us see DEX. Now that we have cards, the next step is to define DEX. Since a deck is made up of cards, it is natural for each deck to contain a list of cards as an argument. The init method creates the attribute cards and generates the standard set of 52 cards. See here code. The outer loop enumerates the suits from 0 to 3. The inner loop enumerates the ranks from 1 to 13. Each iteration creates a new card with the current suit and rank and appends it to self.cards. Printing the deck. See here code, program and output. This method demonstrates an efficient way to accumulate a large string, building a list of strings, and then using join. The built-in function str invokes the str method on each card and returns the string representation. Since we invoke join on a newline character, the cards are separated by newlines. Even though the result appears on 52 lines, it is one long string that contains new lines. Now let us say add, remove, shuffle and sort. Remove. We would like a method that removes a card from the deck and returns it. The list method pop provides a convenient way to do that. Since pop removes the last card in the list, we are dealing from the bottom of the deck. See here code. Now let us see add. To add a card, we can use the list method append. See here. A method like this that uses another function without doing much real work is sometimes called a veneer, where it is common to glue a thin layer of the good quality wood to the surface of the cheaper piece of wood. In this case, we are defining a thin method that expresses a list operation in terms that are appropriate for decks. Now let us see shuffle. We can write a deck method named shuffle using the function shuffle from the random module. Don't forget to import random. Now let us see inheritance. The language features most often associated with object-oriented programming is inheritance. Inheritance is the ability to define a new class that is a modified version of an existing class. So it is called inheritance because the new class inherits the methods of the existing class. Extending this metaphor, the existing class is called the parent and the new class is called the child. The definition of the child class is like other class definitions, but the name of the parent class appears in parentheses. See here code. This definition indicates that hand inherits from deck. That means we can use a method like pop and pop card and add card for hands as well as decks. Inheritance is a useful feature. Inheritance can facilitate code reuse since you can customize the behavior of parent classes without having to modify them. In some cases, the inheritance structure reflects the natural structure of the problem, which makes the program easier to understand. Now let us see class diagrams. A class diagram is a more abstract representation of a structure of a program. Instead of showing individual objects, it shows classes and the relationship between them. See here class diagram. There are several kinds of relationship between classes. Object is one class might contain references to objects in another class. For example, each rectangle contains a reference to a point and each deck contains reference to a many cards. This kind of relationship is called has a, as in rectangle has a point. Class might inherit from other. This relationship is called ISA, as in a hand is a kind of deck. One class might depend on another in the sense that changes in one class would require changes in the other. A class diagram is a geographical representation of these relationships. For example, the above class diagram shows the relationships between card, deck and hand. The arrow with a halo or triangle head represents a ISA relationship. In this case, it indicates the hand inherits from deck. The standard arrow head represents a has a relationship. In this case, a deck has reference to carved objects. The star near the arrow head is a multiplicity. It indicates how many cards a deck has. A multiplicity can be a simple number like 52, a range like 5.77, or a star which indicates that a deck can have any number of cards.